My name's Scott Wendholt. Hello, everyone. I know a lot of you probably were at the concert last night, but not everyone was. So why don't I start by I'm just going to play a little bit. And I was mentioning, you know, it's too early to play, but so many times it is the case that, I mean, I have a 45-minute commute into New York where I usually work. So I can take that time in the car to kind of, I don't know, do some buzzing and stuff. So I do have sometimes even a little more than today, but as much as I like my routine and my warm-up, there are many times where it's, you know, just kind of get off the bus or get off the plane and roll into some venue and get ready for a sound check. So with that sort of disclaimer anyway, but I think I'm just gonna play a little solo on a tune a little bit and see how it goes. Normally I wouldn't want to jump right into music, but like I said, many times have to. So. Tell what that is, what tune that is, if you know it. I was hoping to outline it. You know, have you ever heard this tune? And then it repeats kind of again, so. Yeah, there'll never be another you. That's something I like to get my students doing. I teach at Manhattan School of Music and many other places, I guess. You know, are many other students that aren't through that, but I'm always there and have about five students, and there's always a time, when they're ready for it, we do talk about that for a while, being able to convey a tune, or even if they're really advanced, how to not convey it too well. But give me an idea what it might, for the game. The game is play a tune that you think I'm gonna know. Probably I'm gonna know it. It's possible that I don't though. And then get them to maybe even be a little more abstract about it, but still like something they would play with the rhythm section still though. And then if I get to the point where I'm like, I think I can't get it yet. So have them kind of narrow in to something that's a little more following the changes even more and able to outline the time and even, you know, the things like phrases in the form. So if for those of you who knew, raise your hand if you know that tune. Okay, so I could have been a little less abstract. I could have tried that on you guys and come to the melody a little slower. But anyway, just wanted to get like some music out in the air before I kind of a credential almost, you know, before I start talking for those of you who weren't at the concert. My idea for today is, well, it's always, you know, when I do clinics, I feel like there's a lot of basic things that people are getting, warm-up stuff or jazz scales, or I don't want to take too much for granted, but I when I sit here, I want to think about something that I might have done that you will never have heard of, maybe, that is a little unique, or that you go, oh yeah, I was kind of wondering about that. So I'm going to try to come up with those, you know, some of those things that almost are like in hindsight that I noticed about how I learned some things. And I want, you know, I think it just goes without saying that a group such as this, all trumpet players, are probably going to have many questions to throw my way anyway. I've been in New York about 25 years now. Went to school at Indiana University when Alan Dean was, if anyone knows that name, Alan Dean, great trumpet player, was teaching there. He's now teaching at Yale. Grew up in Denver originally. So I've been in New York about, yeah, I guess it's hard to believe it's been 25 years. And my time there, I've done everything from terrible wedding bands, terrible Latin bands, to such great things, I would say, as the Vanguard Jazz Orchestra, the Thad Jones, Mel Lewis big band as it still exists, for about 17 years now, or the Carnegie Hall big band, or lots of big bands. Bob Mentzer for maybe 20 years or longer with his band, although he's in LA now, so that's maybe changing a bit what that band actually is, although we did recently go to Japan, and it was kind of a half and half as it tips the LA direction. I believe it's going to. It only makes sense that it would. But that's one. Bob Mentzer, Toshiko Akiyoshi for several years. My first trip to Japan was with her. There was a band called the Manhattan Jazz Orchestra you might not know of, because it's kind of a for Japan only band. I don't play with the band anymore, actually, but I did for over 20 years, I guess. That was one, actually, my good friend Lou Soloff, who we all know of his passing a week ago. I think I was in Japan with him maybe a year of my life, all told, because we used to go over for a month at a time. So that Manhattan Jazz Orchestra, what else? They have some other big bands too, but that's kind of enough mentioned. I have six albums out as a leader, which I don't know, that's pretty good for that amount of time. I feel like, it's nice to be recording again. I think I did five and then kind of took some time off, and then starting to do that a little more with my own group. I do a lot of Broadway work. It's funny that how I, you know, that the story, when I moved to town, I hadn't been in town, I don't know, it was less than a year, and I was on one of these rehearsal bands. Actually, this was a pretty good one. And Dominique Duras, does anyone know that? Hands up if you've heard that name. Man, he's one of the best legit slash commercial, do everything, really fine legit player, though, doing a ton of work in Manhattan. He was playing on this rehearsal band, and I just met him that day, and he said, hey, man, you sound good, or whatever, you know. And a little later, he's like, yeah, man, you sound really good. You want to play my show? I need subs for my show. And I was like, what's a show? I mean, I kind of knew what a show was, but sort of, I was so green. And I said, yeah, well, what? Like, what is it? He said, oh, it's a Broadway show, Jerome Robbins Broadway. I'll call you and you can come watch the book. And that, I didn't even know what that meant, watch the book. Now I know that you go in and you follow along and see how the dynamics really, I mean, well, the dynamics socially and the dynamics of the section are, and you know where to go and where the bathroom is, so you don't get there the first day and go, what the heck, where do I go? So it makes a lot of sense to do that. So that's what I did. I watched the book and subbed for him many times, actually, and then kind of went from there, I guess. It's not so easy to do that anymore. You guys might know of that phenomenon. New York is, the whole scene is constricted, and like most, I don't know, overall economic times or whatever. But now a lot of guys want to have shows, and it's, you have to really pay your dues. Then it was kind of, I don't know, guys were busy doing other things and more other things and needed subs, and when they felt they found a good sub, they were like all over you. Because it's when you have that show, I think I've had maybe seven shows of my own, so when you have your own, it is incumbent on you to take care of the chair. So you can take off a ton, but you have to make sure you're sending in good guys or good players, because that you can't get fired from your job necessarily, but it won't bode well for future employment with people that know about that happening, not taking care of business. So anyway, that's kind of a long story about that aspect of what I do. Yeah, I think I've kind of cut out those wedding bands. I do one or two a year. I still have friends that have lucrative, you know, businesses still, and sometimes I'm like, ah, okay, let's. So I'll play the Beyonce songs or whatever with the headphone, with the earplugs as deep into my ears as I can and put them. Which is, as we know, as trumpet players, it's a hard thing to play with earplugs. But in fact, I know one successful person, you know, who's had success doing that. Because a lot of the situations I get in, including the jazz groups, where you're all of a sudden find yourself set up right next to the drummer and the hi-hats here, and he's bashing, you know, to get out to the end of to fill up the room. But I'm 1,000 times closer than someone else, you know. So, yeah. So dealing with the sound issues is kind of another tangent I'm on right now for a second. But anyway, so those club dates, occasionally do them, but find myself now having supplemented that maybe with some better gigs and this kind of thing, touring a little bit and doing clinics like this, and then my one long day a week at Manhattan School of Music that I enjoyed having private students in a combo there. So you know where I'm all coming from. I want to put, you know, that out there. So when I think about those things that I was talking about, maybe some unique things that I can, it won't be for everyone unique, this would be impossible probably, but I think as jazz, well, let me start with jazz wise. I'll talk about kind of just trumpet playing and then jazz stuff. So jazz wise, I feel like I was kind of on my own. Didn't have a private jazz teacher really ever. Even at IU, there wasn't the norm then. Now it is. It changed. But you know, you had your studio teacher, Alan Dean, as I mentioned, and then there were a lot of jazz clubs. Don't get me wrong. I learned a lot about jazz at Indiana University, or that 4 years of, I just got an undergrad, so that 4 years of my life was very productive. But no one really steering me, you know, on a day-to-day basis. So I had to kind of figure out some things for my own, or some things that they made, older musicians that were at IU teachers might have taken for granted. And one was this, you know, this applies, I think, to especially the younger generation now. The fact that there's everything at your fingertips, the internet did not exist when I was in school, right? And that, you know, some of us are older and we remember that. It's bad, right? I mean, it's great to have the internet at your disposal. There's so many things you can do with it. And, you know, someone says, hey, have you heard this? And you can say, wow, if you don't have a copy, I'll keep my eyes open. But it could take like 10 years if you look in, or you're in some record store in Japan. Ah, oh, there it is. Oh man, I gotta get this. I've been looking for this for 10 years or whatever. So that's great that doesn't have to happen anymore, that you know, you can kind of go, okay, there it is, I'll pay for it, or pirate. I don't pirate music, but you know, you can find the stuff anyway very easily. Same goes for even books, you know, PDF versions of books. So that's a good part, but what I find, and that I wish someone would have even told me when I didn't have the internet distraction when I was younger, to really, I did it anyway, but to have someone reinforce it would have been nice earlier on. The focusing on things that now is so hard, like finding one, I talk in terms of albums, not tracks or songs. You know, it was records, LPs that we bought, and then later compact discs, or, you know, and I'd make a cassette tape usually of my records so I didn't ruin them, and then have a way of, you know, making that portable. But just by virtue of the way things were slower and a little more focused. Like I only started with a couple jazz albums, and there wasn't this distraction of like, well, let me check out this and this and this, and I'm sure I would have done that. It's good to take a survey of everything that's out there, but make sure you're all having those albums that you listen to hundreds of times. Does anyone raise your hand if you have an album that you've listened to you think about 100 times? Okay, good. Okay, so there's no magic number. It's not 100, but whatever. The more, the better. But those, when you get into that territory, you know it like the back of your hand. Like everything on the recording, give or take. I mean, I'm not, you know, couldn't write out the drum part for an Art Blakey album that I love, but you know, when he is the main event, that's what I hear. And usually we're talking about the solos and the melodies and whatever's the most compelling thing at the moment. So the more, good morning. The more things that you have that you can count in that category, and when you talk to younger students, or some of us teach at least here, remind them that, you know, the songs maybe that they know, even it might be a pop song or something that's easier to, because pop or like rock music, whatever, is easier to get to that point. It doesn't take as much repetition because the songs are easier and they're more repetitious. So they can identify with that. Yeah, you know that song, you know every single lyric and every single moment of it. Just try to do that with a jazz song. And it might seem too daunting because there's so much going on that it may not occur to them to do that. So kind of giving them that initiative to that motivation, you know, to do that is a good thing. And once you get kind of hooked on that, I mean, you can't tell somebody, hey, listen to this 100 times or listen to this over and over till you learn it. Because if you don't want to, you're not going to. So you have to be, you know, drawn towards doing that. But once you are, then rest assured that that is the most important thing. So if you had one album that you know this well, that's better than having heard 500 albums one time, right? Can we agree on that, probably? I mean, the only albums that I could put in that category are the ones that I truly love probably every moment on them. But, you know, another thing, the analog listening that I was doing, meaning kind of from beginning to end, well, you could, there was music search in my day, but it was kind of didn't work so well. So you put this cassette on or put the side on, and then you get to the second song that you sort of think you don't like, you know? But you'd have to get up off the couch, so let me hear this ballad I hate, or whatever, you know. So you kind of soldier through it, and then it grows on you, or not. But I'm suggesting the ones that did for me, that you'd be so tempted now with your iPod or whatever, to just kind of I'm not in the mood for this now, and whatever. That's not a terrible thing to be able to skip songs that you don't like. But you get my point about. Taking some time for some things to grow on you that you might not initially think are going to. So that's a real important thing, I think, to realize as we have so much at our disposal. Another thing that I did, which was kind of unique, was I knew about transcriptions and transcribing solos, and we can understand pretty quickly, I think, how that might be beneficial. So you're listening to a Clifford Brown solo and you hear it enough times where you're kind of singing along with it and you think, well, I would like to learn this, or someone told me I should learn this, so let me try to write this down. And that's not easy when you first start it, but that learning how to notate things as you hear them over and over is a really important thing. I think that's obvious. But something that I did that was not quite as obvious and kind of was by mistake was learning solos without any preconception of them. Like, so the Clifford example, you hear it enough and you're like, you're drawn towards it, you love it. And that is the more natural way. But I by mistake, this process started for me because I bought this Ken Sloan 28 Modern Trumpet Solo. Some of you have seen it, it's still out there. It's a great, there's two volumes. The volume I got started with Chet Baker on Autumn Leaves and just kept Chet Baker, Randy Brecker, let's see who was next, Clifford Brown, you know, kind of went through the alphabet. 45 minutes, essentially, I think 40 or 45 minutes of music, just the solos that were transcribed by Ken Sloan. And at the time, I bought them at an Abersold camp, and whoever was selling them, I don't think it was Ken Sloan, but whoever had that booth said, hey man, you know, I got a bootleg, you know, a cassette of all these solos. You want to buy it for an extra $8 or whatever it was? It was cheap, you know. I said, oh yeah, yeah. Because I didn't have any of them, you know. That's another thing. I would have gotten home and said, they would have just been notes on the paper. I might have looked at them a little bit, but then I'm sure I would have been like, I don't know. I can't tell how that would go, really. But having the, and now, of course, you know, go on the internet and buy it on iTunes, get the whole, you know, all those Ken Sloan things would be easy to find. So at the time it was an awesome resource for me. And I didn't know any of the solos. I just opened the book. I remember very clearly the first time. And it was a cassette, so I put it on my, Walkman, that we called them back then. And just started playing till, you know, till I was raw or whatever, two tunes in or whatever. You know, I would have just played a couple, and I'm just, you know, floundering. I could sight read pretty well. I was maybe in 10th grade or 9th. I was a pretty accomplished little player at the time. So I was kind of hanging on for dear life and getting some of the easier, slower solos, more of them more quickly. Some of the hard ones, like Dizzy Gillespie, some of it went too high. Some of the, Clark Terry was too fast, or, you know, just something I couldn't get, you know, like his time feel for a while. And some of it I never did really get. It's not in my wheelhouse like it is in Clark. Of course, by definition, everything Clark plays is in his wheelhouse. But who else? Some of the stuff was so fast, like Booker Little had a solo on there that was just, I still can't play it to this date. So I was kind of trying to hang on for dear life, but not really upset when I couldn't. You know what I mean? You know, it's like I just saw it as what it was. And it was just this fun process of like stop, you know, and again, it's analog, so I'd kind of stop the tape. I could rewind it if I wanted to, but probably would just stay there. And when I had my rest was over, turn over to the next page, turn it on again, and go and go and go. So this book, over a period of years, I just kept doing that with it. So now for the first time, it really is sight reading. But it's really damn close to sight reading for a long time, right? That's a lot of music. So, the more you play it, you are not sight reading anymore. But for a while, it really is close. So that's one thing I got out of this process, sight reading, albeit not big band licks or, rhythmically, it was a little more eighth notey, like we do in linear lines on solos, but still, it was me being able to look ahead and kind of, it's hard to practice sight reading in your, in your own room or wherever you're practicing, so that was a beneficial thing for me. And I was, without trying, I was copying all of the sounds, nuances that I'm hearing, meaning bends or even time feel, sound in general. Like, it's a lot different to play like Kenny Dorham than it is to play like Clifford Brown or Freddie Hubbard is very different than Miles Davis. I mean, they're all in like a, you know, like an area that's kind of acceptable or whatever, that, you know, they're not that far apart, but, you know, if we're talking nuance, they are. So I was getting all of those things without trying, of course, when your ear, you know, instructs you to do what it does, you get that. So I don't know, I was taking an overall view of what you could do on the trumpet as a jazz trumpet player and what it felt like to play a really long, great line, or just a great line that had great voice leading in it, you know. So something you would get through transcribing yourself and writing them down, but here was this 28 of them just right in front of me that I came to in this different way of visually and slowly, orally, you know, through the ear. And I think very important step, very important accidental thing I did in my life. I must have played through that thing, I don't know, hundreds of times, because it counted as practice for my parents at the time. I had to practice an hour a day, and I didn't want to. So I found this thing that was like, wow, I can just do this, and they count that as practice. I'm making noise in my room, and then I can go do what I want to do. So it wasn't like I think there's this thing that's really going to benefit me, I'm going to do this. It did benefit me a lot, but this, how I got to it was just total accident of repeating. Has anyone done anything close to that? That's kind of a weird thing, right? All right. But it is, I see one, a hand or two. Yeah, okay. It's easier to do now in a way, too, because there's so many transcriptions out there that you can buy or download, whatever, share, and then you can get the recording, like I said. So you can come to something totally cold where you don't know anything about it. And do this process, or you could do the Ken Sloan book, or any, you know. I think What was good, too, is that, you know, I had not even heard of, I think I'd heard of Kenny Dorham, but I hadn't heard of Booker Little. So I turn the page and it says Booker Little, and I'm like, well, here I am trying to hold on. So it was it was interesting that that would happen because some of the stuff was so hard, and I never heard of these guys, and here I am trying to chug along with them. But it was then when I would go into the record store, I could say, oh, there's Booker Little. I know one of his solos kind of well now. So what is this? Okay, and I can buy it. And that was also going back to that story of all this stuff out there and how to choose. I remember going to Tower Records in New York for the very first time and being excited. You know, I was visiting New York. We're going to go to Tower Records, guys. Okay. All these choices. And I walked out with nothing because I didn't know what to buy. I was freaked out. It's like, well, I'll come back later. I don't know what to get. Whereas if I walked into a record store in Bloomington, Indiana, a used record store, and there was like something that said Booker Little on it, I'd be like, ah, you know, there were only like three or four of those probably. So I was like, I'm taking all four of these, you know. And so that points to that point that I'm talking about of being overwhelmed by everything and just kind of, I don't know, my tendency was to go, if everything was at my disposal, I would just say, okay, I'm out of here. Just kind of freak out, you know. It's maybe the same with learning when we're young and say, oh my God, there's just so many scales and chords to learn in jazz. I don't know where to begin. Instead of actually be, you know, we get help and we do find places to begin, but it can be kind of overwhelming, especially if you think about a listener who comes to this music for the first time, hears jazz. They may think that, geez, there's a decision being made like so often. They're making so many notes, and how do they? They're making this up. This is impossible. So many decisions being made, and then once we get into it more, we see that these decisions are a little fewer. They're like packets of information, or you know, when we, it's like a kid learning how to speak when you learn one word at a time almost, and then string them together. And there's today, as I speak, there will be nothing that I say that I've never said before. I'm just putting it together in different ways, and that's kind of what music is. So, at first, it can just seem kind of like this insurmountable thing, but as we start learning little phrases, and then we're listening, and we go, ah, there's that thing again. Ah, there it is again. Damn, I didn't know it was out there so much, and I just learned it yesterday. I've been listening to this. Now, all of a sudden, I hear, bee-ba-doo-dee-dwee-doo. Oh, wow, that's on every song. Almost, you know, that I ever, but till I learned it, you know, till we made fun of it at the Ebersold camp and learned it, and then every record meant a different thing to me as I was learning the language. I was, ah, there it is again. So as that process unfolds, that mountain seems a little smaller, I guess. So same kind of with the listening thing. All right. Enough said about that aspect. Now, I said I was going to talk about the trumpet thing, and I'm no trumpet wizard, virtuoso or whatever. I can do some nice stuff on the trumpet, but I think I was really talented young, as a young kid, and I had a really good flexibility, could get around the horn. I wasn't such a good high note player because that takes real work, right? You know, and efficiency, you know that. But some days I did have good high chops, and I was just kind of a natural player. And so when my teachers would say, I started in third grade, and I had a good teacher the third grade. And, you know, I remember another guy, Manny Arugio, was probably my third teacher. He was in the Denver Symphony Orchestra, and he would say, you know, he would give me a certain exercise, and I'm sure he explained it correctly, like, yeah, you just, this is, it's not hard, but you have to do it every day, and then, you know, you go a little higher and whatever. And I'm sure I heard it correctly, but I would go home and be like, yeah, whatever, you know, I can do that, I'm bored with that already. So when you're really young, you know, you can kind of be forgiven. But even as I got older through high school and college, I don't think I really had an appreciation. In fact, I know I didn't have appreciation for the physical nature, the sport of trumpet, whatever you want to say. It took me a long time, and I was even, when I was at Indiana University studying with Alan Dean, I learned a ton from him musically, but we didn't do like chop stuff. There was a chop guy at Indiana University, Bill Adam, that name a lot of people know. And these guys were all doing the Adam routine, and it just kind of freaked me out. I was like, wow, they're spending so much time on that. How can they ever get to music? Well, some of them didn't get to music enough, I thought, but some of them did. But it kind of repelled me in a way, because I was either going to be part of it or not. So I was like, yeah, you know, whatever. I can play pretty good already, or whatever I was feeling. And I really wish that wasn't the case. I wish I was more open to, like, checking out what it meant to have a routine, a disciplined approach to practice. And it's odd now that I do the Bill Adam routine, about 45 minutes of it, and I teach my students about it. But I give the disclaimer that I never studied with Bill Adam. I took two lessons from him, the last one being one when I was in college that just I felt like I should do it in my senior year. And then one was a couple years ago, so towards the end of his life. And he was in it, well, gosh, how old was Bill Adam when he died? Who knows that? 93, 94? He was older. So maybe not tracking as well as he used to do, or maybe just his style of teaching was such that I went in and I said, Mr. Adam, you know, you remember me? I was here. Oh, yeah, yeah. I think you remember. Maybe. It's hard to say, though. But he has so many students. But I said, I wanted to show you what I've been doing, the routine, and see what you have to say about it. I've been teaching it with some success to some of my students do it. It's not rocket science, you know, to see what's going on in it. But I thought, you know, he could show me how my approach was good or bad or whatever, you know, tell me things about it. And he said, oh, yeah, okay. And then we just went, whoop, you know, talking about Valvoil. And, you know, I mean, it was a very great lesson. It was hour and 45 minutes probably. But we talked about, I'm really into, like, woodworking, and I work on my own cars. I'm kind of a do-it-yourself guy. I work on my house, do plumbing and all this kind of stuff. So Bill Adam is into more craft stuff, you know, so we got off on many tangents. But whatever that routine, they used to call it the routine, perfect word, the Bill Adam routine. But whatever it is, I think we need to have one. The idea of, and when you're younger, you have to sample different things, you know, different methods, different exercises. But in as soon as you can narrow that down into what is the most efficient thing for you to do and gets your needs kind of taken care of, the better. And then you do that same thing every day, no matter how easy it is. Now, the other things that you may augment exercise-wise, they're also very important, you know, depending on where you're at, what level you're at, or how much time you have in your life. But for me, getting to where I embraced doing the same thing over and over the same way, it came too late. But when it did come, it was very helpful to me for my consistency. You know, having those, I was the kind of player years ago where if I had a day off or so, I'd come out swinging, man. I was great, you know, could do no wrong. I feel like, oh man, it's good, man. I think I've got it together. And the next day I'd be like, oh, pretty good still. But the next day, you know, you hear what I'm talking about. And I would see I remember this on a tour. Was it with, I don't know, Perry Como perhaps, or Andy Williams. And I was every day, so it's, you know, not super hard playing. I was probably playing fourth trumpet or third, I don't remember. But each day I started out great. And each day I'm getting a little bit like, wow, I can't wait for a day off. And the other trumpet players who are better than me, Larry Wiseman, Don, what was his name? It's in Florida now. Don Johnson is his name. I don't know if anyone knows that name. Anyway, these guys were great and lead, more like lead players. They were getting stronger every day on the tour. You know, they were doing things correctly, where I was like, whatever. I wasn't a bad player, but, you know, I think it was mostly not having some fundamental routines, not having a good warm-up, just kind of going, how is it today? Oh, cool, I'm good. And there are days where you can get away with that. It feels, yeah, okay. And days you have to get away with that. But I try to make them few and far between. And this thing that I like as a warm-up, my routine, the Adam routine, I do prefer it at the beginning of the day, but I'll take it whenever I can. So I kind of make the argument that it would be better to play Mary Had a Little Lamb beautifully for 45 minutes perhaps every day than to say one day do Schlossberg's and then I'm going to do some tonguing stuff, and then I'll do some more, just varying things. It sounds good, like, yeah, always do different things, you know. But I, in practice, I think it's more important to have your thing that the body really responds to consistency, right? I mean, when an athlete learns how to do a push-up, you know, or like they're in training for whatever, there's no professional push-ups, right? But you're learning how to do a push-up, and then does the trainer say, okay, yeah, you're perfect, you got it, now we'll move on from there, you don't have to do them again. Now you still do it every day as a warm-up or a conditioning thing. Because the body, as it does it more and more, becomes more, well, stronger in that case, but it's more about efficient, which is part strength, but it's more about efficiency. The Broadway shows that I'm talking about playing, sometimes I play lead on them. In fact, I've taken over lead from Nick Marchione or some great lead players that, you know, it's expected that it's killing and you can't crack notes. Well, kind of, we make mistakes on Broadway, certainly, but it's kind of, it's a very high level. And things that I can barely get through when I start learning them or the first time I play them as a sub for, like, I'm thinking of How to Succeed in Business when I took over for Nick. When I first started doing it, he was still there because I was filling in for him when he was gone. And at first, I could barely play the damn thing. It was really hard. And by the end of it, you know, once he left and I was playing it every day, it was kind of a yawn. I mean, it was still took effort, but it was like I was very confident that I could do it, and if I couldn't get my warm-up, oh well, I would just do it. So the body gets clever. The brain gets clever. It figures out on its own how to play these things. In this case, a show is the same exact way, if it's supposed to be, every single day, sometimes twice a day. So that was very interesting to me as I watched. It's that same concept of the routine. Yes, once I get the show perfect, you know, I'm not allowed to stop because I'm making money doing it every day. So I keep doing it every day, and it just becomes easier and easier as I do it. And I'm not really getting better as a player. That's not why I'm playing the show better. Hopefully I'm getting better as a player all the time. But you know what I'm saying? It's not because I'm figuring it out by anything other than my subconscious figuring out what to do, sort of. I mean, sometimes you say, I'm gonna back off that, I'm gonna hit that a little harder. Yes, there is that involved. But once that's figured out and you're doing it the same way every day, how does that show get so easy? It's just the repetition. So I like to remind myself of that when I'm bored doing my routine. It's a boring routine. It has to become more like a Zen type thing where you embrace it and just enjoy making this. It's because all this routine is for you, for those of you who don't know, it starts out with long tones that on a G in the middle of the staff, and then F sharp and G sharp till you're on, you're just kind of extending the instrument to just a G on the top of the staff and then your low F sharp. And those take about 20 minutes to play, as long as you do play those notes, and the rest in between, which is as long as the note. And then there's the Clark thing that goes. Start on that one. And then same thing. We get out to the last one being, last high one being. So we're not playing anything super high yet, but kind of getting up in, you know, the upper part of the instrument, and then the last one you play, of course, is the low F sharp to C. Those are the bulk of what I do every day. It sounds so simple, and when I look at it on paper, you're like, how can that help? But so those take about, let's say 35 minutes and maybe 40 minutes to get through both of those, and then there's some, we get into lip slurs, but not a whole lot. You could take the routine for hours and hours every day, like I mentioned with these guys. The part that I do gets into a couple Schlossberg lip slurs, and before that, sorry, the chromatic two-octave scales, and those are much more quick to get through. So those are another 5 to 10 minutes, and then I'm finished for the day, sort of, if I have to. The first time I did that, 45 minutes in, so let's say, I just said to myself, wow, that's substantial. I feel like that's more than I would normally do the first 45 minutes of a day. Not always, but I was a kind of player, I would like test the waters. I'd say, Yeah, okay. And I'd make a judgment about, okay, today is going to be really tough, or I'm good today. That's not a really good thing to be doing, I don't think, on trumpet. So starting with long tones, of course, they sound cruddy some days too, a little bit, but I'm not so judgmental. I mean, I want them to sound good, but I kind of take them in stride, and I'm not trying to really judge it and make music yet. I want to make pretty sounds, but I'm giving myself some time to actually warm up before I say to myself, oh, God dang, it's going to be one of those days, I guess. So already I'll get through it somehow, but you set this like expectation of a rough day if you're not careful. So that's one thing that the routine also helped me avoid, I guess, I'll say. So as I find myself, this routine came to me, or a routine, it wasn't just the Adam routine, this process unfolded where I was thinking about aperture control and not really concerned about air so much. I know air is important, but it's not as important as I thought, to be honest. I mean, as we were talking, you guys were talking about air. But yes, it's important, but it's more important how you use it and how you get it out, and that has to deal with aperture. So that was kind of coming into my mind, and it was a slow process getting there, but out of necessity, like going and not getting in really tough situations, like the Broadway lead situations, or I don't know, the many situations that would show me where my weaknesses were. That kind of put the fire under my butt, so to speak, and got me really saying, "Oh man, I got to figure this out better." So that was. I do so many varied. I mean, we in New York, freelance trumpet players, all do a lot of different things. But with the jazz career that I have, and all the big band, and then I feel like I'm really stretched thin. And I like that. I like working on my own cars. I must like doing a lot of weird things, right? So I'm always kind of been of that personality, but till I embraced that, what was necessary to do that on the trumpet, put it that way, it was harder to do, and I was more inconsistent as a player. So I'm sure that makes sense to most of you. But to think in terms of this core thing, that before we get to the new things, or like the things that we also need to work on, or even like music, the rest of the day. I don't practice music so much as I used to, because I'm old, and I have two kids, and I'm busy, and I have to drive into town. I know, I still learn music, and I'm growing, but it's not as fast as it has to be. It's not as much growth as it has to be when you're younger and have more time. Or whatever, at a level where you're still needing to push things harder. Not that, you never arrive, but enough said about that. Any questions about any of those things? Yeah.
This is sort of connecting a few things that you've talked about.
Yeah.
First of all, the disciplined approach to practice. And so I'm a 40-year-old pro who plays all sorts of styles of music, but it feels like lately I've sort of grown stale in improvisation. So I guess my question is, I've never had a teacher. Ebersole taught me a ton in
Me
listening
too.
to jazz and stuff. So what would you tell? I also have a kid and a job and everything else. So practice gets a little bit more limited as well. So what would you tell a person like me, if I were to come into your studio, what's the next step? Or what is an approach to improv? Or what should we be studying? It's difficult to know. What is the next step, and what should you be practicing
Yeah,
in order to improve?
well,
I heard these guys yesterday, those jazz guys, really swinging hard on some of these tunes, and I was like, man, they're so far ahead of the game. How do I catch up?
Yeah, it's hard to me for hard for me to know exactly without hearing your playing. It's within a chorus, it all becomes evident, or even less time. You're like, oh, okay, there's some things. But generally speaking, I don't know. I feel like, yeah, as we look at this mountain, I'll call it my word, of things. that we got to do. It's like, where do we start? It's hard to know. I think I try to impress upon my students, and you may know all this already, but really versing ourselves in, there's a lot of chord symbols and a lot of scales, right? But the bulk of them, the 80% of them, I'll say, is major scales, which we have a good handle on from our, you know, that's we learn our major scales early. The Dorian minor, which is a little weirder because, you know, but we, I mean, as jazz players, we get used to that after a minute. But, you know, sometimes students come and they play the natural minor scale. Oh, yeah, from band. So I try to say, okay, yeah, there's this Dorian minor scale. Let's really learn that in all keys. I'm talking about going up and down. I'm talking, you know, at our Neighborsold clinic or at a Neighborsold camp, you know, we do a quick assessment of where everyone's at to put them in the right combo. I don't teach there anymore. It's been a number of years, but I taught there a lot. And you'd say to somebody, okay, so do you know your Dorian minor scales? And I mean, everyone's different, but I'm talking about the person that says, yeah. And you say, okay, how about your E flat Dorian minor? And they go, and then they play it maybe perfectly. Now, does that person know the E flat Dorian minor? Kinda. Could they play it in, if it's the next chord change and we've got time moving? Probably not. So they're at the first level of, you know, getting it, but they're during that time where I'm going like this, their thought process is, well, that's the second degree of a major scale. Okay, so that would be, and then, okay, and then they got it. So that is the first thing, but we need to get all of our scales, and let me not say all, because that's that mountain again. We need to get all the major scales, so they're just, I like root to root, because that makes them be a finite thing to kind of grasp, and the roots are important to, so when we're thinking of Dorian minor scales, it's root to root, and it's getting them to the point where you really don't need to think. You could be watching TV or looking out the window and they're just, you're just kind of lighting each fuse, right? We know the scales that we know that well, you know. So to get everything as good as our C major, right, is what we're kind of looking for. And it's first root to root, and later it becomes, if we really know a scale, it's probably more like, or whatever, all the mutations, variations we can play on C major. I just did that. Can I do that on B major? No, I can't even. Should I be able to? I guess. Would I be a better player if I could? Absolutely. So why haven't I spent more time on B major? That's a fair question. There's a lot of things to practice, and we do reach our limitations, and we don't play in B major that often. Okay, that's enough reason not to get as deep into it. But I've got it pretty good, and when I get to B major, I got enough stuff to say. But you get my point. So the major scales, Dorian minor, have to exist on that level, and then something for the dominant scale. So what's that? Mixolydian scale? I don't like that mode so much compared to the bebop scale. So yes, I know that the Mixolydian is very close to it, and it's cool. I can play that in all the keys too, but I don't practice that one. If I'd practice, I'm all through the cycle, you know, or maybe, you know, once I can do them through the cycle at that tempo, then I'm going to move up in whole steps or do a different root movement. So all I'm doing is thinking about the root movement, because the rest of it is just a trip of a switch. And that's what we're going to need that in jazz. Like I said, we have to think in chunks where we flip a switch and we're not, it's everything's just going on autopilot. Here's another decision, boom, another decision. But we have to have, and I'm just talking scales now, but later it becomes this more language where it gets you this far. So as we get those three scale types just totally burning, so they're just flowing out of the horn easily, and the repetition it takes on trumpet is greater than most instruments, right? Because we don't have a symmetrical thing here. So there's some other instruments at a deficit too, but pianists, guitarists, saxophonists even, their instruments love to be practiced like this. You know, they just, they pull them down that path. You know, it feels good to learn things in different keys. Ah, move it up a half step. Ah, you know, not to say it's super easy, but trumpet, you learn something, and let's see, up a half step. Nothing here to help me, you know. And that's a big thing. If you got nothing physically changing the notes to help you, that means we have more practice time, unfortunately. One of our crosses to bear, along with high notes being super hard, as you know, whatever. But by the time we get to that point where we realize trumpet's too hard, we say, I know a lot of my scales. I think I'll stick with it. Still a bad decision, but you know, whatever. Something has bit us, and we keep with it. So those three types, if we can be honest with ourselves and say how well we really know them, sometimes it takes some remedial stuff to get them there, or where everyone's at a different place. That leads to the 2-5-1s, you know, and which is so important in standard music. Almost all jazz tunes, you're playing on 2-5-1s. So that's those sentences. If scales are sentences, then the analogy would be phrases, you know, or whole paragraphs. So if that's 80%, the other ones will be, those are the main categories, but then we'll have, within that dominant bebop scale we're using, then there's going to be altered dominants that are important, yes, to become a good player, but they're not as important, I'll say, just in sheer amount of usage that you need for them. Yes, you do have to get to them. So maybe that's where you're at, you know, everyone. Maybe that's where someone is, and maybe they say, well, I've got all my, I'm able to do some 2-5s in all keys. Who knows a 2-5-1, at least one 2-5 in every key? Okay, that those hands need, you know, for us becoming improvisers, it's not that you need to have lots of them, not even dozens, but you do need to have, I don't know, 3 or 4. Let's start with one, though. Let's not look at this mountain again or a hill. Start with one in every key. For me, that was this one. There's that I was talking about earlier. Now that's a perfect 2-5-1. It's nothing crazy interesting, but it's perfect in that it starts on the root. Boo-ba-doo-ba-da. It's just outlining that Dorian minor. I played all the notes in the Dorian minor, so it's definitely outlined. And then a nice root movement by a step. Now on the dominant chord, I've got not just up and down the scale, but that little lick. And you're nice resolution to the root. Roots, roots, root. You know, that's a perfect one, you could say. Although it's not epic, it's perfect. You're tapping into the movement of 2, going to 5 wants to go somewhere, wants to go to 1. So that 2-5-1 that we're plugging into, it's accomplished with that. Now, the next one I might learn or suggest doing for students might be this one. This will get us into, maybe I'll do this one next. Just a little less scalar. Now I'm ending up on the third of the major chord. Still a pretty good note, very good note. Then after those two, so we're getting there, you know, to this list of 3 or 4, right? Maybe this one. That one being outlining the minor chord, I guess, basically, and then coming down the diminished scale, which we'd have to kind of learn before we decide to just play it. But it's a pretty easy scale to learn after the three types I talked about. It's a version of, it's applicable on anytime you see a dominant seventh chord, specifically when you see dominant seven, flat 9, we see that all the time. That would be the best scale choice. So it's this scale. Now So I might take that around the cycle first before I get into putting it into a 2-5. But what did that do when I put that one into a 2-5? It's just that scale. All of a sudden I got alterations like flat nines and sharp nines, which are more than just kind of clever and they actually add more of this motion, this tendency to resolve. Buddha. That, you know, milking it that way shows us, you know, that we're actually, now we're really plugging into that 2-5 motion. We've got to be able to do that, you know. So as we become better improvisers, we're able to turn off and turn on that control of how much of that motion, or waiting to not do any, or letting some go by with not much tension at all, creating some tension that way, like why it feels really, and then when you finally do it. So that, you know, that's a lifelong pursuit to really control that aspect of music. I mean, when as improvisers, we're musicians, I guess, but improvisers specifically, we're learning how to control so many things. But the most difficult thing to get good at is maybe just deciding what notes we're going to play, like voice leading to create good lines. That's a lifelong pursuit. Why, if we had Clifford Brown, if he was alive and sitting here and would agree to say, play a game with us and say, hey, let's play on a tune we all decide, say we're all going to do it, we all know, and let's just play eighth notes and play good lines, hopefully, so that we won't have any, like, you know, no virtuosity, really, virtuosity. I suppose you could play high notes or something, but yeah, that probably wouldn't be the goal if you're just playing eighth notes. But if they wanted to, they could. So that might be a leg up to be an interesting thing. But you're not going to get all of the great things Clifford could play if it's just eighth note choices. But if he agreed to play this game and we all played it and then we taped it and listened to it back, he would be the best, probably, right? I mean, he would. We'd all say, you could actually be objective about it and say, that one, because it makes you go, ooh, yeah, oh, God, those, wow. And it's just note choices, right? I got the same notes to choose from, and I would do pretty well, too. We'd probably listen to mine and say, that was pretty good, too, and whatever. Everyone would fall in a different place, depending on their level. But the point is, that must be super important, then, if just that element. And then once that's, and then if you turn Clifford loose and said, now just play whatever you want, then he'd, nice syncopation and great nuance and bending of notes and his whatever, he'd be able to assert his eighth note feel even more if it wasn't just eighth notes, although that would be, like I said, great too. So if we're trying to be deliberate about as many things as we can as to become good players, that's the one that's absorbing or being better at playing bebop, or bebop is sort of a stylistic word too, but I mean it kind of linear playing and note choices, which is a lot about what bebop's about anyway. But yeah, that's a real long answer for your question. Hopefully that helps everyone a little bit to, you know, kind of think in those concrete terms. Anything else? How are we time-wise? Oh, well, we're getting close, but anything else? How many, raise your hand if you're definitely a jazz player in this room. Okay, and definitely a legit player, orchestral kind of player. Okay, so yeah, that's, as I guessed it was probably going to be, you know, at a competition like this. Well, what else? You know, I guess we can kind of start wrapping it up, but yeah, I guess so.
Scott, you mentioned earlier about doing things in your wheelhouse. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm working on something out of my wheelhouse. I'm working on Tommy Harrell's Joy Spring solo. And
I know that solo.
I don't think like him.
Yeah. Well, you know.
And it's hard.
You know, I don't think, first of all, working on things outside your wheelhouse is about what it's about to practice, of course. unless you're like a young me that just wanted to get finished with practicing. But when you're older and you know, you discover that yes, you want to get better and you're, you know, yeah, you do work on things that you don't get. You know what? I mean, I said I know that. I know of which solo you're speaking of. There's a pretty well-known one out there. I don't know it, though. I haven't learned it, but to be clear. But I think that you don't worry about that aspect of not getting it, because that's how I was when I was young, just not getting anything. I was just allowing whatever my ear was deciding to do to happen. So being able to sound, if you could sound just like whoever it is, in this case Tom Harrell, to the point, I'm talking about, like, if someone was to walk by your practice room and there was like paper on the window, they would really want to knock on it and say, oh, I thought maybe you sound great. I thought maybe Tom Harrell was here. You sound just like Tom Harrell. Ultimately, as artists, whatever, we want to be something different quite, you know, than that. But you could make a pretty strong argument for that even almost being an end game. It's never going to be, because if you can really sound just like Tom Harrell to the point where someone's like, oh, he's practicing a Tom Harrell solo, obviously, you know, that they might, yeah, it sounds a little bit like him. But if you can really cop it to the point I'm talking about, then you really have got something. So look at it that way. See if you can get it as, it's an etude at this point, when you have it written down or you learned it and you're playing over and over with it, by the way, with the recording most of the time, because that's the mimicking at its best, when we can blend with Tom Harrell's intonation. And yeah. Well, so yeah, that can only come from time and repetition. Some of the stuff in there, the wheelhouse thing, you know, nothing Tom does is too crazy. So maybe you can get everything with, you know, time. You know, there, like I said, some of the stuff, I mean, he can play fast, but, you know, normally he's not about just blisteringly fast playing. So that's how I would take it that way. And just sometimes you don't know how it's going to manifest itself, making you a better player. So I'd learned a Tom Harrell solo, I can sound just like him. Now what's that really gotten me? I don't think you know sometimes. In retrospect, I look back and I don't play parts of any of those solos I learned or anything I've transcribed usually. I'm not like, ah, here it comes. But they rear their heads in little, you know, just little parts, and they've informed my when you say instincts, that's almost impossible to learn instincts. They're kind of, but let's use that word. They've informed my instincts about improvising now, and I trust that I'm making better choices that my ear knows, and all of a sudden I'm on a little bit of this Tom Harrell that I might not even recognize. It just kind of gets me to the next thing. So there's a lot of that happens. It's kind of an abstract thing that happens as we learn this music. So in that case, yeah, sometimes you do say, oh, wow, look at that. Oh, it's a tritone substitution that gets Kenny Dorham to play all those really beautiful lines. Oh, look at that, he played it again. So there are moments that are more concrete. Those are obvious why those are important and interesting. But the other ones where you just say, I just like the solo. Why do you like it? I don't know, I just do, you know, or whatever. You know, I'm sure you could think of some reasons, but, you know, if you think about a person who might hear, like, if I'm at a concert and Sonny Rollins has just played a solo after, say, a pretty good high school, let's say college player, he's sitting in with the college band, say, and I see, this is just a kind of story, so hang with me here. There's a listener, I can tell he or she is maybe not a jazz musician, and I see him clap okay for the college student, and then after Sonny Rollins goes, she claps her head off. You know, so everyone does, you know. And so I imagine that if I were to say, stop time and say, hey, what did you like about that solo? You know, some people would be able to talk about what it is, you know. Certainly musicians would say, well, this and that. But the person I'm thinking of would say, I don't know, I just loved it, you know. And they might be able to say, well, I don't know, he played really fast, or I liked he was going dee da 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 da, his rhythmic thing. Maybe they knew the word rhythmic, his rhythmic thing was so cool, or maybe they'd have some of those words. But even if they didn't have that, they're still affected by what he's played, and they, even if they can't say why. So he's controlling so many things, everything, you know, but even they're hearing like certain tendencies within his 251s that they don't even really realize what they are, but they're a scientific thing. They're feeling, whoa. Or he's also controlling his rhythmic aspect, yes, and his, I don't know, how he's virtuoso on the horn. So many little things that a person can't even really know why they like it. And the time, you know, I'm sure you understand a lot of things about that solo, but it makes me think about that kind of that story that I sometimes think about, that you don't have to be, you know, you don't have to know about all the things that are going on to your brain when you're enjoying, you know, great music. You don't have to, yeah, I mean, it might be more enjoyable when you get more into it, but for the person who doesn't, it still affects them greatly and they don't know why. So maybe that's why we play this music. We do. No, I don't know, not to get too romantic about it. Yeah.
I know our time is limited, but yeah. when you find it necessary, how do you approach explaining some of the basics and finer points of embouchure?
Well, you know, I don't know if I get into the physics about it too much, other than to, you know, like, if someone's got a really problem where they're putting it on their face, obviously I'm going to make a comment. Although, you know, there's some leeway there. I look at Terrell Stafford, who I play with all the time, and he's got a funny little way of pulling it off to the side. It's working well for him. I used to play off to the side more, and I was told, no, you will never be a good player unless you move to the center. So I moved it to the center. I don't know if they were right or wrong. So there are situations like that. You know, I think the biggest thing that I like to, if I see someone struggling with, I don't know, range or endurance, I like to talk about that thing that I alluded to earlier, which is aperture control and how to control it. Well, I do talk about playing soft almost to the point of, you know, ugliness in the sound. You know, I'm obviously, you hear what I'm doing. Probably the most efficient point for that note is just this side of ugly, and then putting the air behind it. I mean, there's different notes have a different amount, but I never got it's all about air, Scott. You know, just get a lot of air in. You know, then I would just get it back out through this giant aperture. Sometimes I feel like so. When I was narrowing in on this, different situations I was in. One of them was that Manhattan Jazz Orchestra that I mentioned. It was two trombonists, Bill Watrous and Dave Taylor. So we all know Bill Watrous. Dave Taylor is one of the best bass trombone players ever, you know, certainly alive in New York. And so they're just kind of being beautiful with each other, rapping, you know, and somehow it's like, I'm a fly on the wall, you know, or on the bus, I suppose. And yeah, but you know what brass playing's all about? And my ears perk up, and I'm like, yeah, I'm kind of expecting, you know, it's just about air, you know, air control, something like this. And I think it was Bill Watrous said, man, it's all about aperture control. And then the other one said, you got it. And I was like, ah, my, it wasn't the first time I'd considered that, but I was starting to hear guys, you know, Bob Milliken, a great lead player, would do a warm-up where he obviously was keeping his aperture super small, like almost getting that ugly sound I was talking about. And that you'd be looking at saying, oh man, is this guy gonna be okay? And then boy, when the first note came, it's like just sheer beauty. If you know his playing, Bob Milliken's playing, beautiful, beautiful, everything about his playing, but his sound is so, so great and not small in any way. So get it, you know, when I, you know, not a whole lot of aperture control exercises, although being able to modulate it like I was showing you, just to kind of get used to doing that was sort of important. But it's more the recognition of it being important, like controlling the flow out, and then putting, you know, this pressure that we have, which pressure is supposed to be a bad word, whatever, this, I mean it in a good way, this controlled pressure between the diaphragm and the aperture and embouchure, having those in sync with each other and being able to, you know, play off of each other is when I sort of warmed up to that idea more, that's when I got starting to make inroads to helping with my overall, not just, embouchure was always kind of, yeah, where you put the trumpet, I know you're supposed to be strong and stuff, but aperture meant a little more to me. It requires embouchure, it's part of the embouchure, but that's what kind of spoke to me when I could, you know. And then when you start playing jazz all night and your aperture does this, because it's going to, you know that you're trying, you know, I'm okay with it, but I'm trying to rein it in and keep it, and then keep it from getting too out of control. And then in the next morning when I'm doing these warm-ups, that's what I feel like I'm doing, is getting it back to where it wants to be. So that's quiet, soft playing, the long tones necessarily. You have to have pretty small aperture to get those to all, you know, nothing in my warm-up is out of like above a mezzo forte, more closer to a mezzo piano, getting that aperture back. And then I'm trying to keep it there the whole day. And if I'm playing a Broadway show or in a big band, it's going to stay pretty good. But I'm playing jazz, stretching out, it's going to open up. And you see, I even puff my cheeks when I play. I've got some, that's a no-no too. But so I, you know, it's something I deal with. But that's, you know, that's not so important as the aperture. But dealing with kind of both those things that are happening in my mind, in my head, they don't happen when I'm playing a part or lead. I don't. Occasionally, something will pop out because it's, I don't know. It goes back to when I was a kid going like this, and people would say, "Hey, it looks like Dizzy Gillespie," and kind of giving me attention. I do it again, you know. And I think I might have done. I think I did some damage which I should not have done. But so I deal with that aspect, and I deal with the fact that playing jazz, I got almost even great jazz, you know, better trumpet players, they agree that yes, the aperture is opening up as the night goes on. If you're playing small group jazz, and it's about then trying to get it back for the next day with what you have to do. Anything? I think we're kind of, yeah, I know you guys got to go. We're over time now, so I'll just say, hey, thanks a lot for sitting through it and coming, and best of luck for those of you who are competing, and yeah, enjoy the rest of your time here. Thank you.